word is strong. The rock won't move and his love can't be undone. The rock won't move and his word is strong. The rock won't move and his love can't be undone.
Sing it again.
Oh, the rock won't move and his word is strong. The rock won't move and his love can't be undone.
Again.
Oh, the rock won't move and his word is strong. The rock won't move and his love can't be undone. The rock of our salvation.
Father, for always being our rock. No matter what winds come, what storms come, you are the rock and you're not going to move. Thank you, God.
Please be comfy. Please sit, sit, sit. Enjoy. God is good, huh? I think he deserves a little better clap than the one he just got. God is good. God is good. Tonight's a little bit different. Tonight's a little bit different. Usually we do what we just did, and then, well, we don't always have three baptisms every single week. So that is an awesome, awesome thing. But usually right around now is when I stand up and yell at you for about an hour, and I really enjoy that. I really enjoy that. And thank you, thank you, thank you. I think that might be the first nice thing you've ever said to me. Praise the Lord. He has given me victory. Yes. Awesome. Tonight's a little bit different. Most, if not all, the adults in the room, even the immature ones, Jared, you should have got a noisemaker. Anyone get a noisemaker? I just want to hear that thing. I just want to hear it. Anyone? Come on. Yeah. Tonight we're going to celebrate. We're going to celebrate all that God has done in this church family over the last couple of years. So, thank you. That was good timing. Several months ago, I preached through a series. It was a message series to cast vision before you of where I believe the Lord was leading us, where we would be, who we would be, what we'd be doing in the near future and beyond. But some of that stuff, it's called We the People, but some of that stuff is not just based on what I believe God has told me about us, but it's based in the truth of who we already are, okay? And what I shared with you was a lot of things in that series, but we talked about how the gospel is to permeate every facet of our society, and we're supposed to create a place kind of like this where people can come and there's different programs and ministries and studies and groups and all that stuff where they could come and the gospel could meet them right where they are. But then also we would be a people that would take that gospel and embrace it as our own and then go out into the community, into your homes and into your workplace, into the common areas out there in the marketplace, and you'd share the gospel out there as well. So that's what's been going on here. And I also want to let you know that it's just who we are. Like we also how do I say this? We're a people, like, built into the DNA. I can sense it, is that we're a people that celebrate. We're a people that celebrate. And the reason why I added that to that message series was because what you all just did on your own, like, no one had to encourage you. When you see a life changed by God, you just start clapping and hooting and hollering. You just like to celebrate when God takes a hill. And that was part of who we were going to be. When God pushed back darkness and he takes a hill, we, in this battle against darkness, we would be a people that would celebrate all the time. It's just who we are, and I think it will become more and more so as the time goes on. And make no mistake about it, it is an absolute battle between light and dark. Now, we know this for two reasons. One, because of life experience, right? How many people know that it's a battle? Like every single day when you wake up, you know, I don't even need to explain it. Okay, you didn't see what happened behind you just now, right? Every hand went up. We know it by experience because there's challenges in life that even get us to the point where I don't even want to get out of bed because I know it's coming, right? So we know it by experience, but we also know it by the truth of his word. Jesus said in Matthew 16:18, he said that I will build my church and all the powers of hell will not conquer it. Do you see the wartime verbiage that Jesus, this quiet, gentle, little shepherd, pretty Fabio-looking thing that we see in the pictures? He's using words like building a church. He's a tough guy. And the powers of hell won't conquer it. Like, it's a fight against darkness. It is a battle. But with any war, as you know, there's also, after the war is over, you know there's a triumphant parade, right? There's a parade when there's a war. And after the war is over, the winning army comes back into town and they celebrate the war. They celebrate the win, and there's the plunder and all the spoils of war, and there's ticker tape, and there's confetti, and they celebrate when the war has been won. And let me just say this about celebration. You know, God is extremely serious about celebrating him. He takes it very, very seriously. It's a big, big deal for him. Throughout history, God's people have celebrated him. And he sees to it that as he prepared this book through his people, when his spirit spoke to the people, he saw to it to make sure that this thing was filled with people celebrating him and what he's done. That's all throughout the scriptures. I'm going to give you a couple of examples. Israel and Moses, history says it was 2 million people in the nation of Israel, men, women, and children, animals and supplies and all that stuff, right? And they had just gone through the Red Sea. And I mean, can you imagine going through the Red Sea and there's a wall of water on both sides of you and these big fish are swimming? Like, that would freak you out, right? They just got done. They got to the other side and they turn around and they look and the water crashes down on all of their enemy. Amazing victory, right? Amazing victory. They just watched this happen. And so in Exodus 15, right after that happens, you see all the nation of Israel, 2 million people led by Moses, they get up in Exodus 15, celebrating the victory that God had just shown and proclaiming his greatness, his power, his provision, his deliverance, and ultimately his victory. And in Exodus 15, you'll see it right there at the beginning. Moses and all the people, I will sing to the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. 18 verses go by of praise and honoring God and all that he's done. And Moses and Aaron's sister, Miriam, she goes over and she grabs a tambourine, and it says that she led all the ladies of Israel. So I don't know how many hundreds of thousands of ladies. They all grab tambourines and they start dancing and singing and celebrating all that God has done. And they sing the same thing. I will sing to the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. We are a people who celebrate. Amen? Yes. The Psalms are filled with King David and others, and they're singing songs to God for his victories. There's hundreds of verses I could read to you, but I just stumbled upon this one. I want to share with you Psalm 20, verse 5. May we shout for joy when we hear of your victory. May we shout for joy when we hear for your victory. Listen, I don't know. I haven't been in church that long. Some of you guys have been going to church forever. But there's this image of church where everyone has to sit all quiet and well-behaved. Like the epitome, the apex of Christian success is behavior modification. When the Bible says, what does it say? It says that we would shout for joy when we hear of your victory. That's what we're supposed to be doing in church. We celebrate. We celebrate. In this church versus hell war of light and dark and death and life, there's the hills that Jesus conquers are people. They're people. They're not necessarily places, but they're people. And the Word of God tells us in Luke 15, 7 and 10, that all of heaven rejoices when a person turns from their sin and embraces Christ by faith as Lord and Savior. That all of heaven rejoices when that happens. When you said yes to Jesus, God, listen, you know who's in heaven right now? Who's in heaven right now? God the Father, right? God the Son, and a bunch of angels, right? And when you said yes to Jesus, they rejoiced. Now, I don't know, everybody in here has their own imagination, but just what does that look like? What does it look like when all of heaven rejoices? Now, think about it for a second, right? We were created in the image of God to be like Him, to be conformed into the image of Christ. And He saw fit that in the Scriptures we would shout with joy when someone turns, right? We would shout when Jesus wins. So maybe that's what they did when you said yes. That's it? That's all I get out of you? I'm up here like a buffoon screaming and yelling and no one wants to holler with me. Man, we celebrate. Come on. We celebrate. Here's how we, this is how God takes a hill. This is how God takes a hill. Hi, Marley. Is that the epitome of cuteness right there or what? She's like, who is that absolute freak of nature? Mommy, make him go away. I actually love you. So how does God take a hill? This is how God takes a hill. He does something, right? He acts, He moves, He shows Himself in power, and then He has us tell people about it. That's the simple plan. He moves, He does something, and then we tell people about it. That's a simple plan. Like, you can come up with your own plan. It's just not as good of a plan. That's His plan. We know this. Let me tell you something. Revelation 12, 11, it says this, that we overcome the enemy. The enemy is darkness. The enemy is death. The enemy is Satan. The enemy is hell, right? He's the one who wants to steal, kill, and destroy you, but Jesus came that you might have life. So here's death, right? And so the Word of God says we overcome death, hell, and Satan. We win, God takes the hill, by the blood of the Lamb, what He did on the cross, and the word of our testimony. In other words, this is what I did. Now, how did it impact you? Go tell the world. That's how He wins. That's how He takes the next hill, by the blood of the Lamb and the word of the testimony. Everything is what God has done and then what we tell people about it. That's what we're supposed to do. Remember Isaiah 12 that I read to you. I will tell the nations of all that He has done. That's the people of God. That's what we're to do. We are to celebrate who God is. God is so serious about celebration and proclamation that if you go back to the book of Joshua that we've been studying now for a while, you see that not only did He want people to tell people about what He had done, so they had crossed through the Red Sea, they had crossed through the Jordan River, like incredible miracles, right? Well, not everyone's going to be there to see it. Were any of you there to see it? I wasn't there to see it. So what does He do? He wants people to know what He's done, right? So he tells them, if you go to Joshua chapter 4, do that with me for a second. Joshua chapter 4, you can see what it says. Joshua chapter 4, I'm going to read something to you. When the people had crossed the Jordan River, the Lord said to Joshua, now choose 12 men, one from each tribe. Tell them, take 12 stones from the very place where the priests are standing in the middle of the Jordan. Kind of weird, right? Carry them out and pile them up at the place where you will camp tonight. Verse 6, we will use these stones to build a memorial. Now that memorial word is usually, I don't know about y'all, but when I hear that word, it's almost like a grave to remember someone who died. But that's not God's intention on a memorial. Look at verse 21. He expands on why we're doing this. Then Joshua said to the Israelites, in the future, here's why. In the future, your children will ask, what do these stones mean? In other words, why did you pile this stuff up here? What happened here, Dad? What happened here, Grandpa? What happened here, Grandma? What do these stones mean? Then you can tell them, there's your opportunity to be the word of the testimony, right? This is where the Israelites crossed the Jordan on dry ground. For the Lord your God dried up the river right before your eyes and kept it dry until you were all across, just as He did at the Red Sea, when He dried it up until we had all crossed over. Now, here's really why He did it. He did this so all the nations of the earth might know that the Lord's hand is powerful. Now, listen, if all the nations are going to know, how's that supposed to happen? Who? Point to who's supposed to tell them. Come on, point to somebody. At least point, yeah, he's going to point at me. Point to someone. There was only 2 million people there, and there's 7 billion on the earth. And there's what? 2.5 billion of you. And so it's our gig. We find out what he did, and we proclaim it to the nations. The Lord's hand is powerful, and so that you might fear the Lord your God forever. He's so serious about this celebration and proclamation of his power and strength and deliverance and ultimate victory that he had them build something so people could see it and go, wow, what happened here? Because he wants to make sure that people know about him. That's what he does. So you see, God's people are to celebrate the victories of God, and that's what we're doing here tonight. That's what we're doing here tonight. Now, I'm done really talking here. Just want to share a little bit. Press pause for a second. Shut up. Okay, start it up again. So, a little bit different here tonight. Let me frame this. In Acts chapter 2, the church begins. The church begins, and it's incredible. People are getting saved by the thousands, right? By the thousands. It's insane. And so this is what was happening in the church when all that was going down. It said in Acts chapter 2 that they met in the temple, not here, every day. Who's in for that? Yeah, right. Yeah. They met here every day, and then they met in people's homes. And if you read the book of Acts, not only were they preaching the gospel in the building and in the homes, but they were preaching in the marketplace, everywhere. The gospel was permeating every facet of the culture, everywhere, like crazy. And people are coming to the Lord like crazy. And see, here's the thing, though. Most people in this country, the extent of their ability to see what God is doing is right here. Whether you come here on Saturday night or you go to another church on Sunday morning, like that's most of the people in this country, that's the extent of their experience with the Lord. And that's all they see. When they see the baptisms here, like that's awesome. We have 6 baby dedications later this evening. Awesome, right? 3 baptisms. Like that's insane. Do you know in this church, we've been going for 5 years, we have baptized over 200 people. That's insane. Let me have some noisemakers. I mean, come on, right? God is good. God is good. But look, that's not it. See, lives change. The Spirit of God moves upon people outside of this building. Did you know that? Did you know that? He does. He doesn't just live in here. He goes to church every day. But he also goes to your house every day, and he goes to in your car every day, and he goes to your job every day, and he's at the park every day, and he's at the gym every day. He's everywhere. He's doing his work. He's doing his work through you. And so here's the thing. God's been working, and we have, I believe, a good start on an Acts church because we meet here, and we also meet in other places. There's groups of you that meet in little pockets and homes and places, all Bible studies here and groups here, all over the place. And so what I've asked is I've asked the leaders of those groups to stand before you tonight and share with you what God has done. And this is what I'd like for you to do. When you feel that bubble inside of you, when you feel like, hey, she just told me that God took a hill, I want to hear it. I want to hear the noisemakers. We need to be people that celebrate, right? We should be celebrating. We should be hooting and hollering. You can stand up on top of your seat if you want to. Woo! Let's hear it. Woo! We should be celebrating what God does, right? This is no game. We're in a battle for the souls of all mankind. We're trying to push back darkness and bring life to our community, and we need to celebrate. When people walk into this church, I don't want them to see a bunch of people sitting in pews all relaxed. I want to see them going, "Woo! I can't believe what Jesus did." They want to come to a place like that because there's energy in there. They want to be a part of a winning team. And guess what? Jesus Christ is the winning team, and you're part of it, and we need to celebrate. So when you hear something tonight, I want to hear it. God wants to hear it. He wants us to shout for him. We want to, it said to let the nations know, right? So right here from Revolution Church in Eustis, scream to the world so they can hear about what Jesus has done. Amen? All right. I'm going to ask Kelly to come up first. Do you have a microphone somewhere for him? Where is it? Where? He's got it. Okay, cool. You guys know Kelly? Who knows Kelly? Who doesn't know Kelly? Raise your hand. Hey, that's Kelly.
I love you, brother.
I love you. Awesome.
All right. Live from Eustis, Florida, it's Revolution Church. Yeah. I don't know about that anymore, but what I do know is Moses called me a leader, and I'll agree that sometimes I get to lead, but the true leader of the things that we do on Friday nights, which is when our group gets together, is through Jesus Christ, who's the only leader any of us have. That's amazing. Sometimes he lets me be the guy that talks and goes through me. That's my exposure as leader. I want to talk to you guys about Friday nights. What in the world is Friday nights? You may have heard, hey, there's a group of people that get together on Friday nights. What in the heck are they doing? It started off with just an idea and a question. And I ask a lot of questions on Friday nights. They love questions on Friday nights. Yes. And the question asked is, what does it look like if we actually did what we profess we believe? What does that look like? Because as awesome as it is to gather here with all you guys on Saturday nights, on the rest, there's another 6 days of the week. Well, what does that look like? What does it look like to have Jesus Christ in my life every day of the week? So we went set to find out, and back in January, 2 years ago, it was just four of us that started. And we started asking questions. One of the questions was, what does community look like? What does real community look like with Jesus Christ in it? And I think if you look at Matthew 18:20, you find it. Jesus says, wherever two or three are gathered, I'm there. Yes. So there's our answer. We need to gather together. Jesus Christ is there when we're together, two or three of us. This is community. This is what real community looks like. Is Jesus Christ involved with people getting together? Second question, how do we live out our faith that we profess? Acts 2:42 and 43 says they met together and broke bread together. Trust me, we break bread every week. We eat like kings. Everybody brings something. We have had burgers. We've had taco night. We've had sub sandwiches. We eat well. We gather together and we break bread together. And we live out our faith together. We hear stories of what happened during your week. What struggles did you have? What things were hard? What things were great? What triumphs happened? We celebrate, we laugh, and we cry. And we hold each other, and we poke fun at each other. And it's like no other family. It's our faith lived out, though, because you know what? It's safe. It's a safe place to be. And what does it mean to be a disciple? Matthew 28:20. We talk about Jesus Christ. Yeah, we do a lot of fun stuff. We went to monster truck races, right? But we also talk about Jesus Christ. We talk about his teachings. We talk about what it is to be his disciple, what it is to grow in Christ, what it is to live this life we have with all its ups and downs, with all the craziness that goes on. What is it like to live that with him? Not alone, not by ourselves, but in a community of faith where, you know what, I can cry and laugh and nobody's going to point at me, nobody's going to laugh at me, nobody's going to do anything other than come beside me and help me. These are the questions we're asking on Friday night. And how do we grow as Christians? Proverbs 27:17 says that as iron sharpens iron, one man sharpens another. That's just it. You don't grow all by yourself. Not usually. It takes a community. It takes different people. And it's the idea not of like swords clashing. When I think of iron sharpening iron, I used to think, yeah, it's like two guys battling it out. No, that's not it. You ever take two pieces of metal and you rub them across each other? What happens? Both of them get an edge to them. They become razor sharp. And that's what we're after on Friday night. We want to become razor sharp. We want to understand what it's like to be in the presence of Christ and other people. And that becomes honed. That only happens, once again, with other people. In intimate settings where you can be yourself, where you can come warts and all. Finally, what does it mean to live in grace and love? Because that's what it is, it's acceptance. John 3:16 said, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that none should perish." What a key word, gave. Grace. That's what that grace and gave. That's the same word almost. God gave something we didn't deserve. We didn't deserve his son. We didn't deserve somebody to die for us. We didn't deserve any of that. But he gave it anyway. And that's the most loving act there ever was. So we want to become more like that. How do we give? How do we love? And this world will beat grace and love out of you. It will beat the tar out of you until you don't have any more. Well, Jesus Christ wants to take that back. And that's what we want to find out. Jesus, show us. Help us. We want to know what it is to live in your love and your grace. And it's not about us. We found out it's about everything but us. It's about surrender. It's about letting go and letting God. It's about saying, take me, I'm all yours. I can't do it. I can't do it by myself. I need other people. I need God in my life. And I'm not going to do this any other way because this is what you're telling me to do. You're telling me I got to love God and I got to love other people. I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it. I'm going to try it. And I'm going to see what happens. And so what happens? A lot of amazing things have happened. We've cried, as I said, together. We've laughed together. There's been people that have loaned cars to others to drive states away. There has been people that have repaired vehicles, have mowed lawns, have stepped up, made dinners, have come alongside each other in every way that you can imagine. And you could think, well, those are just nice people. And you'd be right. But the thing is the why. The why it's happening is because they feel the love of Christ, where he's loved them first. We feel that in this group, and we can't stand not to express it to others in a tangible way. And what's going to come next? I don't know. We're just getting started. Jesus is just starting to work on us because he's got us now that we're getting comfortable with each other. And you know what that means when you get comfortable? He's going to call you out. And that's the idea behind the group. Once we got comfortable, we need to start taking this to the streets. We need to start finding out what mission God has for us. What is He calling us to do now? Because this little band, it doesn't need to just be a clique. It doesn't need to be a little just group, and that's all nicey-nicey. No, it needs to go out. It needs to love other people. It needs to show them the same thing that we've experienced by trust, by love and grace of Jesus Christ. Other people need to know this. Like Moses says, it's supposed to be proclaimed, announced, trumpeted. And that happens in some of the craziest ways. It happens in everyday life. It doesn't usually happen in Red Sea's parting. It happens in hugs. It happens in meals. It happens in the most ordinary ways of life. And that's where Jesus Christ shows up and just rocks it. Because He does things and touches hearts through us. It's grace once again. Because Jesus Christ decided, I'm not doing this all on my own. He could do it what? He could snap His fingers and change every one of us. But that's not the way He works. No, He says, I want to use you and you and you and you, and I'm going to work through every one of you. That's how I'm going to work. And that's what we're moving towards. So if you want to come out on Friday night, if that's something that sounds like, oh, I got to get some of that. I got to find out what that is. I want to know more. Talk to me. Talk to me at some point. Talk to Dan, to Katie, to my wife, Wendy. Say something. Everyone is invited. We would like to see more of these groups. We'd like to see more people growing in Christ. More people living their life through Jesus Christ in a way that the world changes, quite frankly.
Amen.
The world changes. Finally, there's the last part that Moses asked me to share was, how has this changed me through this group? And it's sobering. Some of you know a little bit of my history. I was in Tennessee for 7 years with my wife. And we had a church back there. We were going to Johnson Bible College. And the church closed. It's for a lot of reasons. But let me tell you, it broke me. How has this group changed me? Because of the love of Jesus Christ that has shown through these people, I feel like I'm ready to try. I'm ready to step out again. Thank you. It's through the power of Jesus Christ that heals us. He has healed my heart. And God willing, we're gonna plant a church that comes straight out of this place. Because I tell you what, if we had never wandered through these doors, this probably would not have happened. But we did. And the love that is in this church is now going to spread and grow. Because that's what you do. A church is like a living thing. And it's like a woman. It's like a mother. And a living thing does what? It gives birth. It multiplies. That's what living things do. They grow and they multiply. Revolution Church is going to grow and multiply.
Can we pray for him and his wife real quick? They are going to plant a church sometime in the near future. I don't know exactly where they'll be meeting. I guess it's probably in their house, like all the rest of us crazy freaks start, you know, just the way it is. But I'm excited about that, and I hope you guys are excited for them, and I I hope that this prayer right now is the first of many times that you pray for them, okay? Lord, I thank you for my brother and sister, Kelly and Wendy, truly, truly wonderful man and woman of God. What a tremendous gift you have given this church when you drew them into this building. Well, the little building in Leesburg, but into this family. Lord, we thank you for the love and the kindness and truly the leadership that they have both shown to us all. The love that they have shown, the caring, the time, the willingness to serve and sacrifice have been exemplary Christian character. And it's been a wonderful, wonderful experience for many of us here. Lord, as they venture out into those deep, unknown waters again, Lord, I pray that the love that you have for them would exceed and surpass and transcend all the past pains that they have felt when they went through some tough times back at their old church. Lord, I just know that you've been binding them up and just patching them up, and I just feel like it's like they're Rocky, and you are, Lord, you're like Mickey, and you've been patching them up, and you're going to send them back in to the fight. And so I pray your protection over them, your blessing. You are their strength and their song, and you have given them victory. Help them to serve from that place. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you, brother. Love you.
God rocks.
He does. All right. On Wednesday night, there's been a group of ladies that have been meeting as part of this church for several years. And so, Mimi, you guys all know me. Anyone know Mimi here? Now, this is Mimi, and she's going to share a little bit about what's been going on in recent history in the ladies group that meets on Wednesday nights.
Okay, how do I follow Kelly? The man who can speak, and every other word, as everybody knows, is confusing that I speak, and why God has used me in the last couple of months, I don't know. But I'm thankful that he has. And all the other girls wimped out that were asked to speak tonight. We've been meeting, 3 4 years now, 3 and a half, maybe 4 years. We started out at Moses and Meredith's house, and we moved to my house, and then we moved to the church. And so here we are back at my house again. So this has been kind of a roundabout thing. But what impresses me is that the church is a family. It's a community of people who gather together, and for different seasons in their lives too. And each group has their ups and downs, and there are people that are there for whatever God has for them for that time of their life. And we've kind of shrunk a little bit this summer, and we've had like 4 or 5 of us that have been meeting. And it's been really great because it's really been close, and I've seen changes. In fact, 2 of the women that are that were baptized tonight are from the Wednesday night group. Now I can't.
Must be doing something right over there, Mimi.
Well, it's not me. Heaven. Yeah, food always draws. It's not me. It's the Holy Spirit. It's God. It is God who works in this place in a way that, I've gone to church. I've been a follower of Christ. I mean, and a true follower of Christ and believer. I mean, I was out on the mission field working with Navajo children for 6 years. I worked in Christian school. But God has brought me to a place, and it has been a lot of different groups right here in which Kelly's been part of, and others that are here. I mean, I've had to go through some battlefields right there. We had a Sunday night group that we had. We had which was the round table. And those were times where any number of us went through raw raw feelings and raw, you know, just getting down to the nitty-gritty of who we are. You know, you think that you've come spiritually to a place and then you get put in your place. And you come to a place where you find out you're not the nice person that you thought you were. You come across somebody that just totally drives you crazy. And you have people there who listen to you rant and rave about somebody that, you know, you just, anyway. But these are things that we go through. And this is probably the most honest group of people that I have ever been around. And that has helped me because I have always felt inferior, or that I just didn't measure up to other people. And it kept me back. I mean, I've always been one to be willing to go where God wanted me to go and do what he wanted me to do, but there was always in fear and trembling. Well, I'm going to give credit to Kelly and I spent several months in a study. It was just the two of us. And again, this was in where it was the raw feelings. So I know about, you know, the work that he has, and changes have come. Moses has challenged me in ways that nobody else has, to love the Lord God. He has. You know, that our relationship with God is the love type thing. And, you know, that you have to, you know, do you love him? And I've been challenged, you know, in this church by these people, by the Lord. And there's one verse where, well, it talks about Esther whenever she was brought in, and Mordecai, her cousin, said, God has prepared you for such, maybe he has prepared you for such a time as this. And I think we all have for such a time as this in our lives. And I thank God that I'm here right now for such a time as this. And clap for yourselves and celebrate for yourselves, because if it's not right now, it's coming. Your time will come. This is just a training ground. This is just one little step, because that's what our lives have been. I've got to say it anyway. For me, with the group of girls that we've had in our group that right now, Kat was one of them. And sorry, Jay, but what stays in the group stays in the group. But
yeah, you do. Yeah.
I asked Kat, and she said, okay. But anyway, don't want to get any fights going on at your house. But whenever you went away the other week, and she was so concerned about your daughter, and it was like a breakthrough, and she said, I miss my husband. And that is something that I know is because God had been working on in her life and finding ways to love him, you know, to keep her marriage together and finding that love that God can give. That's one of the things I have to really, that's just been kind of an outstanding thing in the last few months, is to see how Kat has been growing in her faith in the Lord. Amen. And how, you know, your relationship is getting stronger. And those are the things that are exciting. And it's something to celebrate. And I'm so glad we're here tonight celebrating.
Amen. Amen. All right, so how do you follow Kelly? You bring Mimi up. And how do you follow Mimi? By bringing up Mark. He doesn't need this, but we'll give it to him anyway.
I'm back.
I love you, man.
I love you, Moses. You know, the question was asked earlier to step up here, and I thought to myself, I mean, what am I going to talk about, you know? I mean, I could be up here all night. But this, for me, it started back in 2008 when I separated from my ex-wife, and I was going through that time, and I met Moses at the job that I work at, and I overheard him talking about that he's a pastor at a church, and I said, a pastor at a church? Why are you working at a car dealership? So it struck my interest, so I asked him about it, and he says, yeah, I'm over there at the Renaissance Building in Mount Dora, and it's a place called the Upper Room. And I said, well, I'll check it out. So I went there on a Sunday morning, and when I went, it wasn't to praise Jesus. It was to learn about this Jesus guy. That was it. It was almost like I was going to take it as a study. I just wanted to go and learn about Jesus. So that's what I did. So I went, and Mary and Joseph were there. They fed me. They won over my heart, and that was it. I've been here ever since. I want the food, you know? So there wasn't a lot of people there. There wasn't a lot of people there. In fact, Andy was there. I remember you. It was so long ago, you know. And so tonight, when you know, leading up to right now, I'm looking around the room and I'm going, man, all these faces, you know, all these people that I've met. And the crazy part about it, not to give you a long, boring story, but I used to rage a lot inside. I still do. I still rage inside, you know. There's a Hillsong song out there. That's called the Prince of Peace, and there's a lyric in there, he calms you down basically when you're raging inside, and when I call the name of Jesus, that's what happens. He calms me down inside, especially at those moments, because I joke, one of my favorite Marvel comic heroes is the Incredible Hulk, and I joke about it because I do turn into the Hulk sometimes, but it's not the Green Hulk, it's the Red Hulk. So. But what I found tonight, and I didn't know what I wanted to talk about, but, you know, Kelly, he finally got up here, Moses touched on it, and what I'm finding is that the common theme tonight is community and bald heads. And a few of you need to shave your heads to be like us. So we could form the Blue Man Group here at church. So I wanted to read some scripture to you, and I want to start off by in Acts chapter 2. Kelly, this is for you, my friend. True believers form a community. That's the theme. All the believers devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship and to sharing in meals, including the Lord's Supper, and to prayer. A deep sense of awe came over them all. The apostles performed many miraculous signs and wonders. And all the believers met together in one place and shared everything they had. They sold their property and possessions and shared the money with those in need. They worshiped together at the temple each day, met in homes for the Lord's Supper, and shared their meals with great joy and generosity, all the while praising God and enjoying goodwill of all the people. And each day the Lord added to their fellowship those who were being saved. And also in Acts chapter 5, verse 14, right there, it ties right back into it. Yet more and more people believed and were brought to the Lord, crowds of both men and women. Jeez. You know, that's the thing about this is community. You know, we're here together. It started off with me just going to a sermon and listening, and then it turned into a Bible study that was just Moses, myself, and this guy Vernon that's part of our family here that's not here tonight, and then all of a sudden it turned into, you know, fast forward to now, it turned into a Bible study where there's anywhere from 20 to 30 men a night. Started off with 3 to 20 to 30 a night, wanting to learn more. You know, I can't imagine what it would be like walking with Jesus in those times. I think about that a lot. I really do. I can't imagine even being by him and watching the miraculous signs that he did, the miracles that he performed. I mean, it's amazing. It would be amazing to see that. So how do you get that? How do you get that? How do you get to feel that? Because we live in a society where we have to touch it, taste it, feel it, see it. But it's not really like that. That's the whole thing about Christianity. It's about the faith. It's about believing in what you don't see. Believing in what you can't touch, feel. That's what it's about. It's the faith. So how do you keep that fire inside, the faith still burning alive in you? It's the community. It's the other believers. I was raised where it was only about family. I'm an Irish Mick, so, you know, I come from an Irish background. And that being said, I was taught that if they're not your family, they don't love you like we love you. So it was always, it was just always about sticking by your family's side. Well, let me tell you something. Fast forward to right now, some of my closest family members are sitting in this room right now.
Hallelujah.
Right now. And how do you do that? It's called love. So I'm going to go to John. John. If I can find it. And it's in John chapter 13. This is Jesus speaking. So if you're sitting in this room and you believe in Jesus, hear this now, because this is him speaking. So now I am giving you a new commandment. Love each other. Let me repeat that. Love each other. Just as I have loved you, you should love each other. Your love for one another will prove to the world that you are my disciples. Now, let me touch on that. There's many men in this room, and you know who you are, that I love dearly, that I've been around for many, many, many years now. Many of you. There's a lot of guys in here. A lot of guys that I have established relationships with, friendships with. And Jared. I love you, Jared.
It's not just me, bro.
I guess it is when you sit up front.
It wouldn't matter where he sits.
But that was tough for me to get outside the box and look and try to love somebody that wasn't my family. And once I got to have a relationship with Jesus, that's the difference. I went to go and find out who Jesus is. Then I started having a relationship with Jesus. Once I established that relationship with Jesus, Jesus established other relationships here with me.
Yeah. Yeah.
And, you know, even though that is Jesus speaking, let me tell you something. That verse there, he was speaking right in the Old Testament in Leviticus in chapter 19, verse 18. This is God speaking. Do not seek revenge or bear a grudge against a fellow Israelite, but your love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord. God, this was tough for me to understand, because people, and I won't get into the whole Trinity thing, but it's hard to understand as far as the Trinity, God, Father, and God, Son, Holy Spirit. Sorry.
Thank you.
Harry, I love this guy. But I heard a sermon on the radio, and the way that and I'm going to try to explain this. God put himself into Mary to become human. He's the image of God. People have a hard time understanding that. So when we speak of Jesus, we're speaking of God. Amen. He loved us so much that he sacrificed himself for us to have eternity with him. That's awesome. So, in return, we have to love each other. We have to, he loved us so much, we have to love him so much for doing that, but then in return we have to love each other. Amen. And show love. And show the humility, the humbleness of what Jesus did for us to others. And that's a tough, tough task. A very tough task. So what did this church do for me? It humbled me and put me in a position where I had to move myself out of my own way. So going back to what Kelly was saying with the community, I can't do things on my own. I fail all the time. I need others around me to lift me up, especially when I'm down. I need that. That's what this church has taught me. And it just keeps growing and growing. And it's awesome. And I love you all.
We love you.
I love you all. Thank you.
Since we started our men's group on Tuesday nights, he's been there. And he really leads this thing. And I think we all should, we're not here to praise any man, but I think we can acknowledge Mark for his efforts. We do meet on Tuesday nights. We usually start what we're doing at about 6:30, just start shooting the breeze, but then 7 o'clock we get to the meat of things. But it's every Tuesday night, 7 o'clock right here. Now we're going to take, I guess, 10 weeks off from that, a little hiatus as we go through Financial Peace University as a church. That way couples can do something together. And so that's what we're doing. So we're taking a little bit of a break. However, there is still a Bible study here for men on Tuesday nights. And Eric and Michael and Jerome and a couple of the other guys, they're here. And they will have their Bibles open if you'd like to come and into that community and learn. Please do so. Same time. Now, we also, how many people know John Tompkins? Anybody? On Friday nights, there's also a group that meets here, and many of you are familiar with that. It's called One Fire. And they started in their home, right? And then, but then when God blesses something, you're sitting in what happens, okay? And so their house wasn't big enough anymore. And so now they're here, but I want to just welcome, and his wife Mia is here also, but I just want to welcome them to come up and tell you a little bit about One Fire, what's been going on there.
Well, first, I'd like to say if anybody's saying they can't get enough God through this church, you're doing something wrong, because they got stuff going on everywhere, and this is awesome. This is awesome. Who's passing out the communion? Hey, you want to go ahead and pass it out now? Because this is going to run right into that.
Do it.
Go ahead, please. So 3 years ago, 3.5 years ago now, I was a wreck. I was a wreck running around on the streets. And long story short, God told me, find Moses. And I've told the story before. I went from church to church looking for a guy named Moses. I get to the church. This little lady comes out, says, hands me a phone. I take the phone. I said, hello, this is John. He's like, I know. He's like, I've been waiting for this call. And that blew my mind. And from that time on, I was baptized. I was baptized in this tub. I was baptized in front of a lot of you. I gave my life to the Lord in front of a lot of you. I've changed my life in front of a lot of you. And there's that spiritual connection that you have. Probably, I'm going to say it was 3 weeks after I got saved, I went to my parents and I said, I've got to tell people about Jesus. I've got to tell people about God. And they said, well, you're still, you know, you're still on this high. You're still on this new feeling and this new belief, and it'll wear off soon. That was 3.5 years ago. And I got married to this beautiful woman and woman of God. And we started a small group on Friday nights with some of our friends here from this church. Some of these kids that were just kind of running around. And I said, hey, why don't you guys stop by? Let's play some music. Let's get in the Bible. Let's talk about stuff. And you guys then go about and do the rest of your night. So I think Harry and Austin, a couple of people showed up. I left the part out. My wife did cook dinner for them, so they were coming over for dinner, and then it turned into a little gathering. But what would happen is they'd bring their friends, and then some of the neighbors would come, and then at work we talk about it, or if we're at the store we talk about it. We invite people, and other people started showing up. We were truly blessed with the house that we live in, and what the Bible says, you know, Jesus blesses us to bless others. So that was what we felt we needed to do, was open our house up. But like Moses said, it got too much. And there was some people, you know, that were like me before I met Christ that we were inviting. And my wife was like, well, I don't, you know, put the money in the safe and lock the stuff up, you know, and I said, baby, don't worry about it. God's got this, you know, and I truly believe that. So again, I prayed about it. What should we do? And again, God told me, talk to Moses. And I'm telling you, I said, are you sure? And I prayed about it, and we actually went and looked at different places. We looked at some buildings, and I said, you know what? I said, hey, Moses, I said, what do you got going on? And it eventually happened where we were able to use this building for Friday nights. And it was a transition from our house to here, and that was 6 months ago. So what we start off as just a fellowship, and we bring food and we allow people to eat and talk and get to know each other, and kind of there's people from all walks of life. There's people from all walks of life. There's young kids, there's old kids, there's families, there's people in between jobs, people in between homes. It's everything. It's a mixture. And we just sit out here. We eat. We talk. And we pray. But then we move into the sanctuary, into this part. And we've got Harry. And he does some worship. And what it is, it's an open forum. And someone described it as being organic. There's no real structure, but there is. There's structure. The Holy Spirit leads everything that goes on. Yeah. And it's just been on my heart from the first day that there's too many people out there that don't know anything about Jesus. And I've talked to Moses before. It's kind of like a church for people who say, I don't go to church. I don't like church. Those people, you know, I don't like those church people. So we try to create an environment for people. When they come in here, they're relaxed. We've had people come in here drunk. We've had people come in here high. We've had people come in here cursing, fighting, upset. And we welcome them. We tell them, come in, have a seat. And they look at us and they're like, you know, they reek a beer and they're like waiting. How long is this going to last? And we tell them, come in. You want something to eat? You want some coffee? And all of a sudden they start to soften a little bit. And when we see that, it's awesome. Yeah. I'm going to let my wife. And it's. Moses is like, when we talk about it, it's not really, we don't have a leader. There's not really a pastor, but it just kind of, we all orchestrate it amongst ourselves. And it's an amazing experience. I promise you, when you come, you're going to leave in a different way. And it's amazing. I'm going to let my wife.
Can I say something real quick?
Yeah.
Meredith and I have a date night every other Friday. Half the time, that's our date night. We come here. We come here to experience what goes on here. It's just it's a way to just get filled back up again after getting, you know, just depleted of all of energy and hope and this and that, and we come here. It's our date night. It's good. And come and taste and see that the Lord is good, please.
Yeah, I mean, all I'd really have to add about that is what God has been doing on Friday nights has just been amazing. It's been mind-blowing. I see people's lives transformed in such miraculous ways through Jesus. I mean, there's no other thing. The Holy Spirit descends upon this place every single Friday night. We don't even know what to expect. We just know that the Lord's going to be in it and something awesome's going to happen. Lately, it has just gone, in my opinion, from awesome to, I don't even know a word that could be even bigger than awesome, but just from here to here. I mean, we've had people healed of things. Chains been broken. spiritual things delivered, healing. The Lord has just been moving in such a miraculous, awesome way. Yes.
It's people come in here and it's almost they're at their last ditch and they're just like, listen, you know, I'm getting divorced. My I'm supposed to get, and I'm gonna tell a story. I'm not gonna give you names. I'm supposed to get divorced today, and I'm here and my wife didn't show up. So I'm like, what do you mean? He's like, and he's sitting there and he's in tears and he's like, I was supposed to get divorced today. I was, you know, I've been married for this amount of time and we were supposed to get divorced. And I said, so what happened? He's like, my wife didn't show up at the courthouse. And I said, okay, so what are you gonna do? He's like, I don't know what I'm gonna do. My life's falling apart, this and that. And we sat there, we talked to him. We just said, hey, did you ever, you know, maybe you're not supposed to get divorced. And it's just a simple conversation like that, and his eyes opened up and he said, maybe you're right. And I said, let's pray about it. And we prayed, and we prayed that night, and the next week he came back with his wife.
Yeah.
And then we prayed. and it's those are the things that happen. And it's God's there, and you know, we just on Friday nights we want to get you warmed up for Saturday night. You know, we want to get you warmed up to come here and to jump up and down and to praise God, and that's what we do. We just want to thank God for what He does, and he wants that. That's the least we owe Him. Yeah. is a couple hours a week. Yeah. That's the least
Come
that we
on.
Owe Him.
Come on.
Harry, yeah. Harry Love's a huge part of this.
Hey.
Love Harry.
I'm Harry.
I just want to reiterate what John said. I kind of blew through that. I mean, it's just a place where we all come together as believers, and we just experience like what the Lord is doing. I know that, you know, coming to One Fire is a great way to end the work week. And I know that a lot of you are thinking like, well, man, that's Friday night, you know, like I've been working all week, my feet are tired, my back hurts, you know, I'm tired, and I understand that, but when you come and you experience the Lord and you get filled with the Holy Spirit and you see a work of God and you see God move in people's lives, there's nothing more that will charge you up.
Amen.
There's nothing that can charge you up more than that.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
You can drink all the coffee in the world. You know, I'm a big coffee guy, and it's not gonna you know, fix your work week blues or whatever like that. The only thing that can do that is Jesus Christ. So if you want to come and experience a move of God on Friday nights, I'm just this is me formally inviting all of you to One Fire.
Amen. Amen. Whatever God tells you, brother.
So we passed out the communion, and I never did this before. And Moses, he said, don't give a whole sermon on it, and I won't. So I understand what communion is, and I mean, I thought I did, and I kind of had a general idea about what communion was. So I started looking it up, and I read in the Bible, and I started Googling a little bit, and I started dipping into it, and I was like, all right. I saw that there was five parts. There was five parts of a communion. And it kind of reminds me of what church is, of what we do. So the first part is restoration. And there's restoration within yourself of getting right with God. And that's as simple as asking for forgiveness. That's as simple as just saying, God, I'm sorry. Acknowledging that what you did may not have been the best thing to do. We can love God. I love God. I've given my life to God, but I have thoughts and things that sometimes aren't the best things. I say some things that probably aren't Christ-like. I know I say things. And it's just at these times that we just tell God we're sorry. And what that does is it builds our relationship with Him. The second part was number two, was harmony. And having a single mind setting of everybody. We all love Jesus.
Amen.
And everybody comes together. We love Jesus. We're here for one reason. To praise God. To thank God for what He's done. The third part was fellowship. And that's what everybody's doing. That's what everybody's up here talking about. Fellowship. Because it's a lonely, cold world out there, believe me. Believe me, Moses and I have had many talks before, being homeless, sleeping in a car on the side of the road. I've experienced loneliness, and it's not fun. And I'll tell you what, since I've become a Christian, I've never been alone. I've never been alone. And I could be sitting in a room by myself, and I'm still not alone, because I know Jesus Christ is there, and he's there with me, and he's holding me, and I just, no matter what I got going on, I know he's there. And man, I wish, I want to go tell every single person I see out on the street that Jesus loves you. Jesus loves you no matter what you think. He loves you. I can't go. Okay. We're here all night. Remembrance, number four, remembrance for what he's done. So when we do drink the wine and eat the cracker, it's an act of obedience. It's just like getting dipped in this tub. This is no special water, but it's just an act of obedience for Christ. Number five is thanksgiving. Giving thanks for what he's done. It says, 1 Corinthians 11:27, so then, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and the blood of the Lord. Everyone ought to examine themselves before they eat the bread and drink from the cup. So when you do this, do it for real. When you do this, when you drink this cup, when you eat this bread, those five steps, think, is this where I am? Know what you're doing. Make this count. Don't waste this opportunity you have with God. Enjoy and reap the benefits and the blessings that he wants to give you. He wants to give this to you, and all you have to do is surrender yourself to him. Surrender 100% of yourself to him. So I'm going to ask you now, if there's something you're holding on to, if there's something that you got to let go, if there's something that you want God to forgive you for, do it right now. Before you drink this wine and before you eat this bread, before you drink the blood and eat his flesh, say, God, forgive me. Forgive me of this. I want to get back on the right track. Because he's got that restart button. His grace and his mercy is more powerful. Topped with his love, it can't be beat by anything. No earthly thing can beat that. One more verse, Mark 11:22. Truly, I tell you, if anyone says to this mountain, go throw yourself into the sea, and does not doubt in their heart, but believes what they say will happen, it will be done for them. Therefore, I tell you, whatever you ask for in prayer, believe that you have received it, and it will be yours. And when you stand praying, if you hold anything against anyone, forgive them, so that your Father in heaven may forgive you of your sins. So, together in harmony and in unity and in the body of Christ, we ask Christ to forgive us, and we drink his blood and we eat his flesh together in his name for his glory. Amen. Cheers.
Cheers.
You!
Amen.
Celebrate, man.
Amen.
That's what it's about.
Amen.
You celebrate what he does.
Amen.
Thank you.
Yeah. When John was talking, he was talking about like loneliness and stuff, and I felt like the Lord put it on my heart to open up like this place, this time for prayer, for people who might be struggling with loneliness, and for like people who have been hurt. Like John was also talking about who you forgive, you know, will be forgiven. And I feel like some of the people who are dealing with loneliness and hurt, it's because they haven't forgiven somebody. And I also want to encourage you, you know, if you're dealing with loneliness, to come in and tap into one of these mini groups that we have meeting throughout the week. And so
I'd like to, I don't want to stifle that Holy Spirit, but we've got like 25 crazy kids behind that door that are about to storm into this sanctuary. So when my wife Meredith is going to share what's going on briefly with the children's ministry in our church, and then we're going to do dedications. When the dedications are over, there's going to be some music being played. They're going to keep playing. And at that time, if you want to come and be prayed for, if you have something you need to confess, whatever it is, if you're hurt, you're struggling, you're lonely, please come forth. Obviously, Harry will be up here. And in the spirit of the One Fire Gang that's here on Friday night, that's what they do. They'll be here. John and me will be up here, and they'll pray with you, and I'll stay too. We'll pray with you. So anyway, that being said, Meredith, if you could bring all these kids forward, please. I know we're going long, but I hope that you're enjoying what God is doing in our midst. So please bring those kids forward. Let's love on our kids. Okay.
Children.
Technical difficulties.
Children.
Sounds like a poopy diaper, I think. All right. All right, kids.
God is good.
Amen. Maybe we need to go into the kids' rooms and they need to be in here. Why don't y'all say hello to the Revolution kids? That's cool.
Well, I see I've lost a few on the way. There's some straggling back there that have gone to sit with their parents. But I guess it's my turn for the evening. Let me share a little bit. Let me go back to the beginning. 5 years ago, I walked into this church, and I teach children, and I work with them 5 days a week. I said, I'm not going to work with children. I'll, you know, talk and find and see if there's people that I know that can work with children. But I'm not going to work with children. But unfortunately, neither was anybody else. So it became my project. And so from 5 years ago, I've been with these children. Saturday would come. And I wasn't very pleasant. I was kind of dreading what I had to do. I did it 5 days a week. I didn't want to have to go back in and on a Saturday night and do it. I'm being honest. I didn't enjoy it. I wanted to come and hang out with the adults and have fun and worship and praise God. But somebody said, you know what? Why don't you guys join us and start praying with us? And I'm like, that is so awesome. We're going to do that. We're all going to come at 5 o'clock, if you're teaching with the kids, you're gonna come at 5 o'clock. Not gonna, you don't have to, it's up to you. And we're gonna start praying. Well, we started doing that. Oh my lands, God is amazing. My heart changed. I'm excited about Saturday nights. I'm excited to go up there with these kids.
Amen.
I love each and every one of these children. They are fun. They each have their own personality. They each are learning amazing things that I don't even know that they're learning about. Let me tell you a little story. I have one that sometimes he's on his head, or sometimes he's under his chair, or sometimes he's pushing somebody else. But it's okay, because I found out that he understands that the Holy Spirit lives in his heart.
Amen.
He understands that, what did we learn about last week?
God.
God. He told his mom and dad a story, and I didn't even know that he was listening, but he went home and he told the whole entire Bible story. God is good. Amen. And I am excited. We have gone through a couple different series. We've learned about the Beatitudes. We've learned about Proverbs and how to live right. And right now, Skylar, what are we learning about right now?
We're learning about God's armor.
Amen.
God's armor. God, what do we know about God's armor, Skylar?
The belt of truth.
The belt of truth. Well, that's as far as we've gotten. So he's doing really good. Tonight, I have an abundance of helpers, and I'm so thrilled and so excited about that. But I could always use some more. So anytime you want to come and join the fun, because it is fun. And it's, like I said, changed my heart. I'm having a wonderful time. I'm loving these children. They're incredibly awesome. And anytime you want to come and spend some time and hang out and find out what they're learning, you're more than welcome to come. Amen. Guys, anybody want to share anything? No. Nobody wants to share anything? No? A Bible verse, maybe?
No.
No? Can somebody share about you? Well, and I also want to say thank you for the amazing helpers that I do have.
Yes.
I have Katie Johnson, who comes up and helps upstairs. And I have and Amanda Johnson. I'm like, wait a minute, I said the wrong name, but they both have Johnson as the last name. I have Kat that comes and helps, Katie, Alan that comes. I have a new helper tonight for the first night. It's Shelly, and
Shelly.
She did a great job.
Yes.
I also have Beth, who comes, and she's a big helper. And then a handout to Mr. Ben.
Yes,
Mr. Ben,
the faithful one.
So it is a big deal. These guys are going to be our future, and I pray that we can get the Word of God into their hearts so that they can worship Him without having to go through any pain or heartaches, that they can learn it from the beginning and they can see us as examples to these children.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you guys. Thank Love you, you all.
Love
oh,
you.
I'm. Oh.
Yeah, what we're going to do now, we're going to do child dedication. So if your child is to be dedicated right now, of course, stay up here with them. If not, all the children can go back to their mom and dad. Right now, mom and dads, so we're all in here. All those who are dedicating their children this evening, please come forward with your children. Just kind of line up right here, please. Mark, this is incredible, man. This is insane. Freaking me out. Alicia and Wendy, they all help as well. Give them a shout out, please. We always forget someone, of course. But loved. While they're all coming up here, I want to let you know we've got several birthdays in the house. And so we want to make sure before you leave, you go back into the lounge. We're going to enjoy some birthday cake. I know that today is Jimmy's birthday. Today is Marsha's birthday. I know that Angela just had her birthday. I don't know who else had their birthday. I don't know if I'm forgetting someone, but if it's your birthday, happy birthday. You are loved.
Yeah.
Here's some of you have asked what dedicating a child is. Way back in the Old Testament, in 1 Samuel, there was a lady named Hannah, and she wanted a child. And she couldn't have a child. And so she pleaded and begged with the Lord, please, Lord, give me a son, give me a son, give me a son. And finally, he blessed her. And the Lord gave her a son. And so what happened was when she took the son, she realized where that son had come from. And so she brought that son back and presented him to the Lord, dedicated him to the Lord, made a commitment right there before the Lord. This is your child. Of course, we raise our own children. Mary and Joseph raised their own child. Not our Mary and Joseph, we're talking about the Mary and Joseph of the Bible. But they too, even though they raised their own child, in the Gospels you'll read that they did just like Hannah did with her child. They brought Jesus Christ and presented him to the Lord. And that's what we're doing here. These moms and dads have made a decision that not only are they going to follow Christ, but they are going to teach, they are going to teach these children about Jesus. They are, I'm going to ask you all two questions for all the parents. I want a commitment from you. And you're doing it, count the cost, you're doing it in front of all these people. This is your church family. I'm going to ask you, do you make a commitment right now to teach your child about Jesus Christ? Yes or no?
Yes.
And when you make a commitment, and by God's grace, to live with Christ-like, to model Christ-like character before your child so they know how to grow up to know and love him. Would you do that?
Yes.
You'll do that. Now I want to ask you, church family. Remember Kelly and everyone who started with Kelly and everyone who's got up here said it's all about community. That we can't do this alone, right? No mom and dad can do it alone. They need us. And you're their church family. You are their family. You are their family. They say blood is thicker than water. It is. It's the blood of Jesus that brought us all together as a family. And so I want to ask you, count the cost. Will you, their family, commit to help them teach these children to know Jesus Christ? Would you do that? Raise your hand. Would you commit and by God's grace live with Christ-like character before these children so they might get to know Jesus? Would you do that? Raise your hand. I want to ask you to keep your hand raised. Keep your hand raised. I want to introduce you just so you, in case you don't know. Well, she's been roaming around all night. This is Marley. Can you say, look at little Marley, right? This is Marley. This is Lucas. Right? This is MJ. This is Malachi. This is Joshua. And this is Landon. You all know them now, right? I want to ask you to join me, family, and pray. And pray for these children and for these families. Would you do that? Can you put the lights down a little bit so that nobody can feel uncomfortable? Nobody can feel uncomfortable. Turn them down. Turn them down. Let's just pray for these people. Pray for these children. Lord God, we are standing in your presence right now because of what Jesus Christ has done. We stand in your presence, holy, blameless, and without fault. Lord God, we thank you for that. That's insane privilege. When we speak of privilege, Lord, we're privileged when we have children. They're a gift from you. And each one of these beautiful children is a gift from you, Almighty God. Lord, we pray your great blessing upon these children. We pray, Lord, that you will bless them. We pray, Lord, that you will save them all, that every single one of them will come to know you and love you and be a worshiper of the Lord Jesus Christ, that their salvation would be soon, that their salvation would be deep and real and forever, and Lord, that they would grow up to know you and love you for an eternity. Lord, we also want to lift up the parents. We lift up all these parents. It's so hard, Lord. The world is out to get them. The world is out to grab these children and to teach them things that are not of you, to send them down dark and evil roads. And Lord, these parents, they need your help. So all of us here, as we lift our hands to you and kind of just kind of point them over these parents, Lord, we ask that you would cover them, Lord, that you would be their strength and their song, that you would give them victory, and that these parents would be strengthened right now in your spirit to be able to parent these children so they would come to know you and love you. right now, Lord, they are all committing these children back to you, acknowledging that these children are yours, not theirs, not ours. These children are yours. But you've given them to us, not only to their parents, but to us as a family, to steward them, to take care of them, and to guide them down that path into your loving arms. So we commit to you now as a family that we will teach these children about you, and we will model Christ-like character before them that they would know who you really are. We thank you, and we pray your great blessing on all these families in the name of Jesus. And all God's children said, amen, amen, amen. Amen.